jump down to verse 9 and see how far we get, and we'll go back and forth and talk about it a little bit. So if you're following, you don't have to follow along, but if you are, we'll be in 1 Kings, verse number 1. Is this okay? Did you guys accept anything you wanted to talk about?
Okay. 19:1.
Yes, sir. Stop. 1:3. 1:3. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, also how he had executed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah, saying, "So let the gods do to me, and more also, if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time." And when he saw that, he arose and ran for his life and went to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, and left his servant there. So that's the story that Pastor Kearson, we were talking about right there. We're leaving that spot right now, so it's pretty amazing to be there. But the thing that I want you to notice is it's true to say that Elijah ran from Jezebel, but it's really not a complete thought, because he didn't just run from Jezebel, but he ran specifically from a word that Jezebel shared. Now I want you to think about this real quick. Think about the logic. Hopefully we saw a little bit in Jonah to make us realize, if we think a little bit harder about some of these Bible stories, there's more logic that we can glean than what's on the surface, which seems kind of weird. Like the whole story about the gourd, it makes a lot more sense when you think about it in terms of justification. But here you have Elijah, who's just had no problem slaying at least 450 that we know of prophets of. I don't know what he did to the 400 other prophets of Asherah, but that's a pretty big deal. By the way, he's been out there arguing with these prophets and pouring the water, as Pastor Keir shared with us, and taunting their false gods and saying, you know, maybe they're on a walk, maybe they're asleep, maybe they had to use the restroom, keep trying, whatever. And then he only had to take a little bit of time for himself. But the preparation in that battle was like an all-day battle. That was 12 hours plus of and people were there watching and waiting to see what was going to happen. And they were not very, it was kind of like, you know what, whoever loses is going to die. We've been out here a long time. This is ridiculous. And they lost, and of course you know what happened. But how do you go from being like that level of machismo to like one lady says something sideways to you and you run away like a scared little boy all of a sudden, right? That's a huge shift in mentality. So you have to wonder what more was going on there. And one indication is where he ended up, which is inside of a cave alone with his thoughts. And the idea of the cave, which is an Eastern idea, is that, you know, that you're cut off from your surroundings. It's dark, it's lonely, it's a deep place, a place of deep thought and analysis, so to speak. But it's also considered the place where, like, your ego deals with yourself. That's, I guess, a more psychological way of looking at it. That's what happens when you get alone with your own thoughts, you know. And that indicates possibly that something she said sparked something that he was already afraid of. And the only reason I have any license to assume that is because of the question that God asked Elijah and the answer that Elijah gave. And so we'll pick up in verse number 9.
Technology. Verse number 9.
And there he went into the cave and spent the night in that place. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. And he said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?"
Keep going.
So he said, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God of hosts. For the children of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they seek to take my life."
I'm going to get right back to you.
So, right away there you see, "Elijah, why are you here?" He doesn't say, "Because I'm scared of Jezebel," right? But something that she told him caused this thought process in his mind, which indicates that's a thought process he's been dealing with for a long time. That's a pretty deep response. Like, they've killed all of the prophets, they've slain, you know, all of my, those of my occupation, if you will, maybe even those of my family. And now they seek after my own life. Like, this was a fear that was deep-seated that he had, that this would, this seems to be the end of prophets. Like, this is how a prophet's life goes. He prophesies, everybody gets angry, everybody rises up, they start to conspire to kill him, and then they kill him. And so Elijah's seemingly suffering with this fear. He actually says, and I don't know if that we read it yet or not, but he actually says, you know, I'm going to be no better than my fathers. That's the real struggle that's going on in his mind. It's not that, like, I think Jezebel's so fierce that she's going to kill me, but she reminded me that I'm not going to be any better. Somebody, they want to kill me, and she does have power. Obviously, she's royalty. Another thing to realize here is that she has some authority, but she's not the king, right? So whenever we're looking at the spirit of Jezebel, and we'll bring it back to Elijah's story in the cave here in a moment, the spirit of Jezebel is not just like some type of like liberal feminist seductive spirit or whatever the case is, that whatever people think about the spirit of Jezebel, but it appears to be, if you just go by biblical reference, the spirit of Jezebel is a spirit that speaks in the name of the king but does not speak the words of the king, or does not speak with the full authority of the king. And that's what, like, Jesus was dealing with when he was in the wilderness for 40 days, right? The enemy came to him, and what words did the enemy use? He used the words of the king, right? He used the scripture, didn't he, to try to tempt Jesus? So he's using the words of the king, but he didn't have the authority to speak in the name of the king. And that's the same thing that Jezebel was doing here. And it caused Elijah to have to deal with what seems to be a deep-seated fear that he'd had for a long time. We'll continue the story.
Reverend,
well,
yes, sir.
Then he said, go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord. And behold, the Lord pressed by.
Can y'all hear?
You gotta hold
and
up
a great and strong wind tore through the mountain and broke the rocks into pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, the earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a small voice. So it was, when Elijah heard it, that he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood in the entrance of the cave. Suddenly a voice came to him and said, what are you doing here, Elijah? And he said, I have been very zealous.
Pay attention to this answer.
I have been very zealous for the Lord God of hosts. Because the children of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they seek to take my life. And the Lord said to him, go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when you arrive, anoint Hazael a king over Syria.
Okay, hold on one second. I should have had you read verse 4 earlier.
I'll
explain myself.
I want you to read verse 4. I had you hear the answer the second time on accident. You should have heard the answer the first time. So right after Jezebel made that threat, God asked Elijah, verse 4, he says, but he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness, and he came and sat down under a juniper tree and requested for himself that he might die, and said, it is enough, O Lord, now take away my life, for I'm no better than my fathers. And so that was his fear at the beginning. Then what Rennie read was he goes into the cave, and the Lord asks him, why are you here, Elijah? In verse number 10, Elijah said, I've been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, and the children of Israel have forsaken my covenant, thrown down their altars, and slain the prophets with the sword, and only I am left here to seek life to take it away. And then he had him go out and stand on the mountain, and we just read the story. So he shows him all these powerful things, like the moving of the earth, the fire, the wind, all of these things, and God was not in any of it. after the earthquake of fire. And then he heard a still small voice. And it was so, when Elijah heard it, that he wrapped his face in his mantle. He went and he stood in the entering of the cave. And behold, there came a voice unto him and said, what are you doing here, Elijah? So it's the same question that God asked two times. So at the beginning of this experience, he says, what are you doing here? And Elijah gives him an answer. And then God says, go stand in the precipice of the cave and let me show you something. Come out of the deep loneliness of your thought and let me show you something. And God shows him an array of power. And he shows him the earthquake. He shows him the fire. He shows him the whirlwind. All the things that he can do. But God says, that's not where I'm at with you, Elijah. And then he hears a still small voice after showing him these things. And he asks him the same question again. Why? What are you doing here? Now, I want to relate this back to the very first man, Adam, because God asked a similar question. And of course, if you're thinking logically, you're like, God already knows the answers to these questions, right? So you know what happened in the Garden of Eden. They ate the fruit, and then Adam sewed some fig leaves together. They were hiding themselves because they saw their nakedness, which is, they became self-conscious, right? That's why you hide when you're naked, because you're self-conscious of how you look, right? If you don't hide when you're naked, then you have other issues. So that's what they didn't have before they ate the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil. They didn't have that self-consciousness. So when God says, Adam, where are you? He knows where Adam is, so what's the point of him asking? You know, he needs Adam to understand where Adam is. So I want you to confess. I want you to tell me what you're doing. And so Adam has to say, you know, I'm hiding from you. And so now we have a conversation going. And God says, well, why are you hiding? Let's figure this whole thing out. And they get to the bottom of it. And there's a solution. And the solution is basically this. Adam, I have to remove you from the garden. Because the way this is going to work, if I'm going to redeem you, is you can't be hiding from me and making me find you. I'm going to remove you from the garden, and now I'm going to become hidden, and you're going to have to work to find me. And that becomes the story of humanity, is that we're all seeking God. It's not that God's far from any one of us, but we're looking for him. It doesn't work the other way around. Not saying that he's not putting forth any effort, don't misunderstand me, but it is our job, it's up to men and women, to accept and believe and give our lives over to him, right? Like, it's our job to find him because he's there waiting. Does that make sense? And so with Elijah, there's a similar thing going on. Why are you here? God already knows, you know, why he's here. But he needs Elijah to say it out loud. And then once Elijah says it out loud, he shows him all of this wonderful power. You don't have to be afraid. You know, there's so much that I can do. But in the still small voice, he says, now, Elijah, tell me again why you're here. And the interesting thing is, Elijah answers the same way both times. So it's not about the answer, it's about the perspective, right? Elijah says, I'm zealous, basically, for you, and I'm afraid they're going to kill me. God deals with him in that space, and he says, now tell me why you're here. And he says, I'm zealous for you, and I'm afraid they're going to kill me. But the difference is, I'm not going to hide in a cave because of it. I'm going to be okay with it. I'm going to accept it. And I'm going to go ahead and do whatever you ask me to do. And then God says, good, because now I have some things for you to do. I want you to go to anoint this new king. I want you to anoint this new priest. And I want you to anoint Elisha, who's going to take your place, so your mantle can be passed on. But you have to find that place. I'm just trying to relate to you another part of Elijah's story in your own life. You have to get alone in that cave, so to speak. You have to deal with your own self and your own ego, and you have to come to the place where you're going to decide, no matter what it costs me. You know, we all have those fears in the back of our head, in the back of our mind, that we have to deal with. And all it takes is one Jezebel to bring that to the forefront and send you running into a cave. But in that cave, you have to decide, it doesn't matter what it costs me, Lord. It doesn't matter what it costs me. I'm here to serve you, and I'm here to follow you. I'm afraid my friends aren't going to want to be my friends anymore. Well, that's why you're hiding in the cave? Well, let me show you who I am again. Let me remind you. And now let me ask you again. What are you afraid of? Well, I'm afraid my friends might not like me anymore, but I've decided it's okay. I'm going to go ahead and do what you've called me to do. My family might persecute me, but it's okay. I'm going to go ahead and do what you've called me to do. It might cost me my life, but I'm going to come out of the cave with that same answer. In other words, what I'm trying to project to you is another story you can relate it to, and this could take all day, but I'll just one point is the snake that they lifted up in the wilderness on the pole, right? They were all getting bit by fiery serpents. They're having this whole conversation like they're all, you know, God's upset with all of them. The fiery serpents are in the desert. They're biting them. They're killing them. And so all of the Israelites are like, hey, Moses, can you go talk to God about this? This is kind of a big deal, you know? And so Moses is like, yeah, we'll have a chat. And so he does. And God says, make a bronze serpent and lift it up on a pole, which is the weirdest response ever. You would expect that they'd have a chat. They'd say, I'm sorry. And God would be like, okay, I'll call off the serpents. But he doesn't call off the serpents. Instead, he says, make an image of a serpent, lift it up on a pole, and tell everybody to look at it. Why is that? Because God's trying to get a point across that I'm not here to deliver you of all of the difficulties in your life. I'm here to give you the strength to face your own fears. And if you're willing to face your own fears and look them directly in the face, then what's going to happen is I'm not going to magically make all of your problems go away, but you're going to become braver. You're going to become stronger. You're going to become more courageous, and you'll eventually be able to overcome the fears that stagnate you. And so it's the same concept with Elijah. It's like the answer to why he's in the cave doesn't change, but the actions surrounding that answer completely change. God deals with him and gives him the strength to face his own fears. And anyway, I thought that would be sort of an important lesson that we could learn from Elijah since we're on Mount Carmel. And we had 15 minutes to kill, so I hope that makes sense to you guys.